in order to do the kinds of things that I enjoy. I do them because I'm supposed to do them as part of my job description. I try to transcend that. I try to make sure that I see students and see them on a personal basis, but really all I'm called on to do is to put in a couple of hours on my office door. These are the office hours that you can see me. And if you don't watch it, I'll do something that'll remind you to a terrible place, namely that committee. And the committee will say no before hearing what it is that they're saying no to. Here's my theory. When you break up a human act so that tens of thousands of people are doing it, and they all amount to a single act, namely the act of taking a flight from here to Chicago, let's say. I'm doing that. It's a wonderful thing to be doing. But it takes 10,000 people or more to make it possible. 10,000 people. There are some things that take 100,000 people. These all amount to a single act, a single social act. And I don't find that the single social act convinces me that there is any kind of plan, any kind of reason, anything that's that I can rely on that governs all of this. Have you ever lost your luggage on the airlines? You're bounced from here to there. It turns out the luggage ends up in Seattle. How did it get to Seattle? Why to Seattle? Well, you know, nobody would take responsibility. That's the very nature of the kind of world we live in. We don't want to take responsibility. I only work here, this woman told me. I only work here. Not only that, but there's a sense of incredible passivity. Passivity, you know, a kind of the sense that no matter what you do, it's not good enough because it doesn't connect up in the right kind of way with what is possible. I feel manipulated because the only thing that anybody has an interest in this world of ours, is getting things done. How efficient is it? Can we do it? Can we do it cheaper? Can we do it faster? Can we do it not better? Okay. So here's the theory. Let me see if I can put it in this way. Mediation is the word that I like to use. And I'll tell you exactly what mediation means. Mediation is when I place someone or something between me and the result. Okay? So when I want to use a screwdriver, a screwdriver mediates my action, because if I didn't have a screwdriver, I would have to go ahead and try to do it with my thumb. Well, it's not going to work. Tools are mediators. They make all kinds of things possible that otherwise would be impossible. That's tools. Language is a mediator. I explain to people what I want done, and sometimes they actually do it. Ideology is a mediator. It's a mediator because I don't have to do anything like thinking. You know, I already know what I'm supposed to think. What I'm supposed to think about war and peace. What I'm supposed to think about Vanderbilt as against Alabama. That hurt. I'm in a position where there is no end to the kinds of things that happen to me through no agreement of mine other than the kind of agreement that is involved in holding down a job. Are you with me? Your eyes tell me you are. And I like that. All right. So what are the consequences of mediation? The consequences are, number one, that I feel very passive. I don't feel empowered. I feel that things are running over me and I'm essentially impotent in doing the kinds of things that I love to do. But I can't do them because there are experts who say, don't do it. Or experts who say, do it, but do it my way. Do it our way. So passivity, impotence. Impotence leads to a kind of rage. That's what I was talking about when I mentioned the guy in Vegas. A kind of rage that is insane. I mean, knock out a window and start shooting. There was a person in California who walked into the office of the mayor a few years ago and said, you wouldn't listen to me, would you? And shot him dead. The idea that you don't have a hearing, you know what I mean by that? That's who do you go and see? I always say go and see your representative, go and see your senator. Well, you know, good luck. 11% approval rating for Congress. That's up from 9. So it's moving in the right direction. Okay, passivity, impotence. What I call psychic distance. Psychic distance is the sense that these acts that are being performed and to which I contribute, that these acts are really not my acts. I just do them because it's part of my job description. So imagine what it's like to put yourself in a situation where you say to yourself, look, wash your hands of all the things that you do because you don't mean them, you just do them. Well, that way lies not just immorality but insanity. You just do them. You don't take responsibility for them. And then there's manipulation. When you're dealing with these chains of intermediaries, these chains of mediation, as you deal with them, you find more and more that you're not in control. You're not even in control of your life. You know, I worked in a bank for a summer and a fall. And the wonderful thing about the bank was that there was nothing that I could decide. Absolutely nothing. It was a matter of do this and don't ask why. Do that and just do it. At one point I was asked to bring money from a bank and I stupidly asked the question, do we have an account there? Well, they thought that was incredibly stupid. Banks exchange money for paper. That's because money is paper. And it's just a different kind of paper. And I didn't understand that, but it didn't get explained. So here I was with a pile of money that I'm carrying down, you know, several blocks away, scared out of my mind. So somebody comes along and says, you got some paper, you got some money. I'll take the money and you can keep the paper. The sense that you're not in charge of your life. bank story ends with the terrible recognition that I would take a deep breath at 8 o'clock in the morning and exhale at 5 p.m. and that everything that I did in between 8 and 5 was something for which I didn't want to take responsibility, something that didn't make any sense to me, but it was necessary because that's how things are. So in summary, what I'm trying to convey is that because there's so many of us, the social acts that we perform are magnificent, but they come at a high cost. They come at a high cost because here we are, all of us organized by some organizers, that's the intenders, all of us engaged in minute fragments of action, which all add up. And eventually out comes the social act, which supposedly is helpful and enjoyable. The trouble is that the psychological outcome of this is not the same as the social act. The social act is magnificently well organized, at its best, that is, not at Penny's. So it's well organized, but the psychological act is thoroughly, how am I going to put this, not to be crude, because I want to make it just as crude as conceivable. What I want to say is the psychological act is one of absolute frustration. It's something that we don't really want to be engaged in, and yet we continue to do it. Okay, so I think I've got time to talk a little bit about what to do about this.